The poor shepherd boy David, he was raised up to become the king. Are you with me? The poor Joseph, who was a dreamer, he was a visionary but a dreamer, he was raised up to become the governor of Egypt. So today I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, you may be very poor, you may not have any capabilities, you may not even have, you know, you may have nothing which the world esteems as something really good. But I want to tell you, if you make your life available to the, in the hands of God, he can build you up into something that is so beautiful for the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Because he is a mighty architect. He is a mighty potter. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So all that we need to do is not to depend upon our abilities, but to depend upon the ability of God. Hallelujah. Because he can transform you into something so beautiful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you'll find even in the breaking of bread and all that, you know, when God says, do this in remembrance of me, it is not just the finished work of the cross at Calvary. He just do this in remembrance of me would actually be do this in remembrance of every covenant promise that I have given you, everything that I have done for you. Do this in remembrance of me having come down to this earth to save you, to give you life, to give. So it's the totality. Are you with me? Do this in remembrance of me means do this in remembrance of Jesus, who has come down to earth and has revealed himself as a son of God, as a son of man, to save each one of us. Are you with me? That includes every area of your life. So we have to remember that when we put our trust in Jesus, when we come under the lordship of Jesus, that is something which he's asking us to remember. Why I want to tell you this is, if you read the book of John chapter 6, you will find that when you have the Spirit of the living God in you, he will bring to your remembrance all that I have told you. That is what the word says. So the remembrances of everything, every covenant promise that God has given each one of us. Because some people restrict the breaking of bread to just that Last Supper where Jesus died at the cross at Calvary. That I would say was the culmination of his ministry on earth was the death. No, it was even fulfilled in the resurrection. Are you with me? Many believers finish the work of Jesus at the cross at Calvary. But I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, we have to today move over from the cross at Calvary to the throne in heaven where Jesus is now seated. Are you with me? Because the word of God says very clearly in the book of Corinthians that if Jesus had not risen, then our faith is futile. Are you with me? The only difference, or rather one of the greatest differences between Jesus, whom we worship as God, and all the other worldly gods, is all those people died and they are rotted, their corruption. Like I told earlier, that their bodies saw corruption and the grave, they are captives to the grave. But Jesus' body never saw corruption and the grave could not hold him. And he resurrected as a King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he is seated at the right hand of the Father. That is the difference. That is what makes him God. Are you with me? Hallelujah, hallelujah. So you'll find there is such a great difference. So when he says, do this in remembrance of me, we must understand, do this in remembrance of every covenant promise that I have given you. Hallelujah. And one of the greatest things, my dear brother, my sister, that we must always understand is that our God is faithful. Say, my God is faithful. Hallelujah. And he is worthy of trust. I want to tell you, because the book of Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11 says, hallelujah, that he has a plan for you. A plan for not for your destruction, but plan for your prosperity. A plan to give you a future and a hope. Are you with me? So whatever be the circumstance or situation that you're going through, I want to tell you that if you are in the hands of the Master Potter, that he will build you up into something beautiful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It may be worthwhile to recall what Pastor Rajesh said last Sunday, where he said, you know, there is a trumpet which is made out of silver. Hallelujah. And the trumpet which is made out of silver, one is that it has to go through a purification process through fire. Are you with me? Silver to be purified has to go through fire, and after that the silver to be made into a trumpet has to be beaten. Are you with me? Oh, such beautiful words, such revelation, insight is there in all those words. So I want to tell you, you may go through fire, you may go through beatings, but I want to tell you, God can build you up into something beautiful for his glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So we must put our trust in him. Another thing, as Esther, she did not look for promotion from anywhere else from the Lord. So today you and I, when we look for a promotion, we must look where? To the Lord. Because the word of God says in the book of Psalm, chapter 75, verse 6, he says, for promotion comes neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south, but God is the judge. Are you with me? Hallelujah. Today people seek, I'll tell you one thing. Today people are not able to give their lives to Jesus because they're looking for the approval of man. They're looking for some promotion from the worldly realm. But I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, the promotion which lasts, which nothing can destroy, is a promotion that comes from God. It does not come from the world, but it comes from God. Hallelujah. So how many of you want that promotion? Hallelujah. So seek his will, and then you will find that the promotion comes from there. Because you will understand from the book of Philippians, and you know, this promotion, I want to tell you, see, Jesus, when he lived here on this earth, he was trying to give us he was becoming a true example. Are you with me? He was not trying to act God. He was not trying to act God. He was trying to give us a true example which each one of us can emulate. If you read the book of Philippians chapter 2, you will find that Jesus gave up his divinity. He came down on earth. He was born just like one of us. And he suffered and died a cruel death so that you and I could live. And then the word of God says in the book of Philippians, hallelujah, chapter 2 verse 9, it says, Therefore. See, because we read earlier, God, our God is faithful. He will reward the work of your hands. Are you with me? So it says, even for Jesus. It says, therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him a name above every name, that every knee shall bow in heaven on earth and under the earth. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Therefore, that is why, what is it? Therefore, he submitted himself to the will of the Father. Today, I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, if you submit your life to the will of the Father, to Jesus, God will also exalt you and give you a name which is above every name, give you kingdom authority. Are you with me? Are you with me? So Jesus was trying to tell you, what I am getting here is something which you can also get. He was trying to just demonstrate what is possible. Are you with me? The possibility was being demonstrated, not just in words, but in action. That is why he says, you will do the same things that I do. You will do even greater things that I do than I did. Oh, are you with me? Today there are many, many people who say believers, they say there is no Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit has gone. No, I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, Holy Spirit is very much here amongst us. He is working amongst us. He is leading us because Jesus says, I will not leave you an orphan, but I will give you a helper who shall abide with you forever. Hallelujah. Because Jesus in the book of Matthew chapter 26 gave a promise. I shall be with you unto the end of the age. Jesus is here unto the end of the age by the presence of his Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Are you with me? Because the Holy Spirit is actually called the Spirit of Jesus. Hallelujah. Are you with me? So you must understand that when God says that I will be with you, I will give you an exaltation, it is a promise that each one of us are capable of getting it. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Like if you read the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy, Paul says that I have fought a good fight, I finished my race, I kept my faith, and now there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness with the righteous judge will give me. But again he says, not only for me, but for everyone who eagerly waits for his coming. So I want to tell you, in the scripture, this is not just some history book about some conquest and some act. This is something which each one of us are capable of attaining. Hallelujah. Oh, are you with me? Hallelujah. It is not stories. It is things which are realities, which each one of us can do it if we have the faith. Hallelujah. That is why, if you read the book of Galatians chapter 2 verse 20, it says, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Because it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Hallelujah. So I act like, I see like Jesus, I walk like Jesus, I talk like Jesus, I think like Jesus. Hallelujah. So I do the same miracles that Jesus did. Hallelujah. It is into that, that is a promotion that the Lord wants to give us. That is the promotion that the word says, you know, promotion does not come from the east, north, or the west, but it comes from the Lord. Hallelujah. So it is as believers, we need to make that our own. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Again, you understand one thing. There was, you know, that If you read the book of Mark chapter 9 verse 29, it talks about there is a relationship with Jesus, with the Father, that is required for us to exercise this authority. He says this kind, you know, the situation was there was a boy with epilepsy and the disciples could not heal the boy, and therefore they came to Jesus and says, why this, we are not able to do it. Then Jesus says, this type will come out only by fasting and praying. So there is a relationship that we need. And he says that this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. So today, I want to tell you that, you know, when you pray and fast, there is a release of God's power. See, again, I want to tell you, I mean, this is something, my dear brother, my sister, we have to understand in the spirit. See, what Jesus did is something we can do. And what Jesus did is something we must do. Are you with me? We must do and we can do. Say, we must do. We can do. See, another thing what Jesus did. If you read the book of Philippians, Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Jesus was able to start his ministry. What did he do? The book of Luke chapter 4. He says, then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Are you with me? So he's led to the wilderness for what? To spend time with God. Then what did he do? Next verse says, being tempted for 40 days by the devil, and in those days he ate nothing. And afterward, when they had ended, he was hungry. See, from all this you can understand, Jesus was just like any one of us. He was hungry. Are you with me? He was hungry. And when you're hungry, that's the time when Satan said, turn the stone into bread. Are you with me? That is a test. So you'll find when you are under stress, there will be a lot of tests, but how did you overcome? It is written. Are you with me? It is written. So you'll find here, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to pray and to fast. And when this was done, what happened? Let's turn to verse 14. Verse 14 says, then Jesus returned. Say, then. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. So he spent time in fasting and in prayer, and then he says, then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and the news of his went through the surrounding region. So when you fast and pray, the power of God is released into your life. Hallelujah. If Jesus needed it, I want to tell you again and again, Jesus needed it. Before he started his public ministry, he had to spend time in fasting and praying. Now if you've got a spiritual gift, and if you walk to work on that gift, you need to fast and pray. Are you with me? You can't say, oh, I'm a believer. I go to Cornerstone Church every Sunday. I come, I go other worship and all that. I have my personal prayer. I do this, I do that. No. If you want the release of the gift, you need the power of God. And the power of God is spending time with God and fasting and praying. Hallelujah. If Jesus needed it, do we need it? We need it even more. Hallelujah. So you'll find, hallelujah, there is something that happens in our life. There is a demon of short-sightedness that will be taken away from you. Hallelujah. What is the short-sightedness I told you earlier? That I can't do anything. Oh, I am a small, I'm a humble, ordinary person. I will just listen to the pastor talking. I will just obey whatever he says. You must talk and you must listen. But God wants you to do something more. See, every time you go for some meeting in wherever you go, one of the greatest prophetic words that God speaks to his children through the preachers are that God has a great plan. I can see prophets here. Did you hear? I can see teachers here. I can see evangelists here. I can see people ministering to the Lord here. The gifts are hidden. Are you with me? The gifts are hidden. It need to come forth. Are you with me? So for that to bloom, to come forth, we need to fast and pray so that the Lord will reveal. How will he reveal? The word of God says in the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 18 that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of your calling. Oh, are you with me? The eyes of your understanding must be opened that you might know, you might comprehend what is the hope of your calling. What is the gift that is hid in you? Oh, are you with me? What is the gift of God that is hidden in you, that the eyes of your understanding might be opened so that you will have a revelation knowledge of that? And then, what does it say again? It says, and so that the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints may be revealed. I think we should read that. See, in the Malayalam word, it is not translated properly. Oh, hallelujah. We'll just read that in the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 18. Oh, it says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. Okay? So that ends with you. That what is the hope of his calling on lives of each one of you. Yes, brother, sister, your life also. And then it says, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? His, that H is Jesus' inheritance. Why are you with me?
Hallelujah.
One is the hope of the glory that you have, and that glory is the riches of the inheritance of Jesus in his saints.
Hallelujah.
How does it become his, how does it become his inheritance? Because he paid the price to own you.
Hallelujah.
Are you with me? Because he paid the price to own you, you and I are belonging to him. It is his inheritance. And the glory of that inheritance is when the hope of is revealed in your life. And when you are able to, the eyes of your understanding are opened so you can understand what is the hope of your glory. And you start working on the spiritual gifts. That gives the glory, reveals the glory of his inheritance. Oh, hallelujah. So I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, there is so much God wants to do through each one of us. So we need to pray. We need to pray, Lord, reveal what is the gift that you have given me. And give me the grace and the ability to exercise the gift so that I will be fruitful for the kingdom of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Then again, you must understand that we have actually, as a church, we must have oneness. Actually, those of you who came and heard Bishop Wiley talk here, one of the key themes that he was talking about was about unity in the church. Are you with me? About unity in the church. And one scripture, and beautiful scripture which he read, was from the book of Genesis chapter 11 verse 6, which goes like this. And the Lord said, this is about building the Tower of Babel. You all read about that, the Tower of Babel. Okay, it says, and the Lord said, indeed, the people are one, and they all have one language. And this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Why? Because they have one mind, one purpose, and one language. Are you with me? So when you have oneness, when you have unity of purpose, then nothing can be withheld. This is a spiritual principle. This is a spiritual principle, which again, if you look at Matthew 18, it is translated, it says that if you in one accord ask for anything in my name, it will be done.
Amen.
Oh, are you with me?
Hallelujah.
So Tower of Babel, even though their purpose was not pleasing to God, God revealed acknowledged a spiritual principle that if you are of one mind, one language, and if there is unity, nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible even for God. So he has to take away the conditions of that unity. So he split the people and gave different languages. Oh, are you with me? So he had to change the conditions of that impossible thing to do anything. The possibility of doing anything, he had to take away one of the conditions. And the conditions was language. So he took away the language and gave them English, Spanish, Mexican, Hindi, Malayalam and all that. So they could not understand each other. Once they could not understand, then there was no unity. So today I want to tell you, my dear brother and sister, if you have one language, actually the language is the spirit of the living God. If you have one language, if you have one accord, one unity in the church, nothing is impossible for us. So this is something which we as believers, we need to exercise this. Put into practice this spiritual principle of that nothing is impossible when we as a church have one purpose, one goal. Hallelujah. How many of you believe that?
Hallelujah.
Belief is only setting a foundation. How many of you will work for that? Hallelujah. That is because one is an intellectual understanding, the other is to put it into practice. So if we agree that we have to work for one goal, what is that one goal? To lift up the name of Jesus. And for what? To give glory to the Father.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. If you do that, and I want to tell you, every work of yours will glorify the Father. Hallelujah. Not for our glory, something, you know, people say, oh, this is a fantastic church, for this is beautiful and all that. No, those are all, you know, ministering to people. But we should transcend from that and start ministering to God. Are you with me? Where our only sole purpose and aim is to lift up the name of Jesus and to give the glory to the Father. Because the word of God says, when I am lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Hallelujah. So in whatever we do, we must have the one purpose and the goal to give glory to the Father. Because I tell you one thing, even Jesus' goal was that. Because if you read the book of Philippians chapter 2, I told you earlier, 9, 10th verse says, what does it say? It says, if you read 9 and 10, it says, and therefore, he gave him a name which is above every name, that every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess, in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Are you with me? If you read the word, you find Philippians 2:10, it says that. So even Jesus' sole purpose in coming into the earth was to give the glory to the Father. I want to tell you that a psalm, it says, you have been created, I have been created for the glory of God. So in whatever we do, the benchmark must be, is this glorifying God? That must be the benchmark. That must be the question that we ask. Is what I'm saying glorifying God? Is what I'm doing glorifying God? If that is, there is a backing of heaven with you. Nothing will go against you. Hallelujah. Again, book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 10 says, now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. See, when we talk of a language, it is a unity of purpose I'm talking of. One thing. And I would say it's all about Jesus. You speak about Jesus. You think about Jesus. You look about the exalting his name. And that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Today, if you want unity in the church, we must have the focus. That our focus must be to lift up the name of Jesus. Anything that does not do that is not according to God's purpose. Because book of Philippians chapter 2 verse 5 again says, let this mind be in you, which was in Jesus Christ. Are you with me? So we are supposed to be just like Jesus. Because why? The book of Genesis says that we have been created in his image and likeness. Are you with me? So that is what God wants us to be. But we have departed from that because of sin. Jesus Christ has given us the ability to come back into. He has restored. He is not only a deliverer, but he is also a restorer. So he is able to give us the same thing. So we must have, let this mind be in you, which was in Jesus Christ. Again, corresponding verse you will find in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 16. Paul says that we have the mind of Christ. Because we have the mind of Christ, he is able to understand what eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has a human heart perceived, what God has kept in store for people who believe, who love him. So that revelation knowledge is something which we need. As a church, we need that. Today, what we need to pray is for a great breakthrough in that area of our lives, so that our eyes of our understanding are enlightened and the blindness will go and the light of God will shine upon our lives. Again, 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 13 says, no temptation, trial has, or temptation, actually it is trial, the Lord, because God never tempts you. God never tempts you, he only tries you. No temptation has overtaken you except such as are common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So you'll find whenever God tests you, that there is always a way out that he gives for you. So you understand, I mean, like children are here, you know, you have to go for a test, right? When you pass the test, what happens? You get promoted. So every test is followed by a promotion. Hello? Are you with me? Every test in your life is followed by a promotion. Hallelujah. So when tests come, you can be sure there is a promotion which is not far behind. Behind. Hallelujah. 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 So God will always, a test is followed by a promotion. Say, a test is followed by a promotion. Yeah. So we, again, another principle which we need to understand is we need to pray unceasingly. We need to pray. Because prayer is power. Say, prayer is power. Hallelujah. If you read the book of Ephesians chapter 6 verse 18 to 20, you'll find Paul is telling there, pray unceasingly in the spirit. Hallelujah. Because Paul, even though he is a great minister of God, he's a great apostle, he still needs prayer. Today, I'm telling you, everyone, especially people who are ministering to God, needs prayer support. Prayer support, like I told you earlier, is fire, air power. Are you with me? Prayer is air power, because that is when there is in a spiritual battle, you'll find that the prayer support is actually air power that you give. Hallelujah. The book of Ephesians chapter 6 verses 18 onwards, if you read, you'll read that, hallelujah, it says, praying always with all prayer and supplication of the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So this is not only for Paul, it's for every believer. Because the word of God says, woe if I do not preach the gospel of Christ. Are you with me? It is a duty of every believer to preach as Paul preached. And we need prayer support from our brethren. So that is again one of the things that I told, the unity. That when the purpose is that our purpose in ministry is to lift up the name of Jesus, then there is no competition. Because if you are ministering, to lift up the name of Jesus. If you are ministering, lift up the name of Jesus. So where is the competition? But if you are ministering to lift up your name, and if you are ministering to lift up your name, then there is competition. Are you with me? So if you have one purpose, that is to lift up the name of Jesus and to give all the glory to the Father, then there will be nothing preventing you from praying for her and she from praying for you. Are you with me? Because the purpose is the same. So that is where the Christians have to come into a greater level of maturity. My ministry does not end with my church. My church in the sense, you know, there is a worldly church. My ministry does not end here. My ministry is actually to minister to God. And there is only one God. Hallelujah. When that happens, my dear brother, my sister, something great is going to happen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. John 10:10 says that the devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I come to give you life, and life in all its abundance. So the abundant life is only in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Another thing I want to understand clearly is in the book of Esther chapter 7 verse 1. So it says, so the king and Haman went to dine with the queen Esther. Then there is a great thing there happens. And on the second day, at the banquet of wine, the king said to Esther, what is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted to you, and what is your request? Up to half the kingdom, it shall be done. So the king was saying, whatever you ask me, he was probably so impressed or enamored or whatever it is with her, he was willing to give her up to half the kingdom, the king of Persia. Are you with me? But I want to tell you, my dear brother, my sister, there is a King of Kings who is willing to give you not half the kingdom, but the whole kingdom. Are you with me? Are you with me? There is a King of Kings who is willing to give you not half the kingdom, but the whole kingdom. Let us go to the word. Hallelujah. Because I like to support everything with the word. Hallelujah. Let's read the word of God. Hallelujah. In Luke 12, verse 32. I tell you, there are so fantastic promises in God's word. If only you would believe. That is what God says, no? If only you would believe, you would see the glory of God in your life. Hallelujah. 32 says, hallelujah. Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.